The message of today is taken from the first and second lessons that were read to us. The first lesson, the book of Ezekiel, chapter 36, reading from verse 1 to 15. And the second lesson, the book of Matthew, chapter 7, verse 15 to 29. If someone can steadily read the first lesson from verse 21.
But I have pity.
Matthew 7, 21.
Now,
yes.
Everyone that saith unto me,
yes.
Lord, Lord, not everyone that saith unto me,
not everyone that says unto me,
Lord, Lord,
Lord, Lord,
shall enter into the kingdom of heaven.
Shall enter into the kingdom of heaven. Thank you. This is the message we've been hearing all the days of our lives as Christians. Now, before we go further, I'd like to take a quick toll. If you've been a member of this parish for at least 7 years, raise up your hand. At least you've been attending this parish for at least 7 years.
No way.
Okay, thank you. Now, if you've been a member for at least 3 years, raise up your hand. At least 3 years. Okay, let me do it again real quick. If you've been a member for more than 7 years, raise up your hand. More than 7 years. Okay, now if you've been a member between 3 years and 7 years, raise up your hand. Okay. Now if you've been a member for at least 1 year, raise up your hand. All right. Thank you very much. We'll get to the point I'm trying to make there. Now, the verse says, not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven. Now, you and I are here today. We're worshiping our Lord and our Savior, Jesus Christ.
Yes.
We've been calling upon his name day and night since the beginning of the year. Some of us have been calling on his name for more than 7 years. Some of us, all the days of our lives. We call upon his name, we pray, we worship him, we sing, we read the word. But now the word is telling us today that not everyone that calls upon my name will enter the kingdom of what? Heaven. Now the same second lesson from verse 24.
Therefore,
it says, therefore,
whosoever heareth
this saying of mine,
and doeth them, I will liken him unto a wise man.
Now, as our sister is reading these verses, let's pay attention to the key words. Start again, please.
Therefore,
yes.
Whosoever heareth this saying of mine,
he says, whosoever heareth this saying of mine,
and doeth them.
So we might have been hearing the words of God all the days of our lives, but are we doing the words of God? Now, the Holy Spirit is telling us today that those who hear the word of God and put them into practice, continue.
I will liken him unto a wise man.
He says, I will liken him unto a wise man, yes?
Which built his house upon a rock.
Which built his house upon a rock, yes?
And the rain descended.
And the rain descended.
And the floods came.
And the floods came.
And the winds blew.
And the winds blew.
And beat upon that house.
Yes.
And it fell not.
And it fell not.
For it was founded upon a rock.
Because it had its foundation upon the rock. Now, I'm sure we all know the rock this verse is talking about. Our Lord and our Savior, Jesus Christ. Rain is good. One of the songs we sang this morning says, let the rain of God's blessings fall upon us. Right? There are times when we want rain and there are times when we don't want rain. Imagine you walk in a city where you have to take public transportation. And the weather forecast didn't forecast rainfall that day. So you don't have your umbrella with you. Now you have to walk from either the bus station or the train station to your office building. And all of a sudden, it begins to rain. What happens? You get wet. Right?
Yes.
And when you get wet and soaked, you are not comfortable. But there are certain times, like when if you've ever lived in certain countries and you know the light situation is not good, and on a Friday night you have been looking forward to resting, but all of a sudden there is no light, the weather is hot, what do you do at that time? You'll be praying for rain so at least to cool down the weather and you can have a good night's sleep, right?
Yes.
Now, but this verse is telling us, read it again one more time, please.
Therefore,
yes.
whosoever heareth the sayings of mine.
Whoever hears the words of God and puts them into practice. Them,
I will liken him unto a wise man.
Unto a wise man, yes.
Built his house upon a rock.
Yes.
And the rain descended.
And when the rain descended, now in this case, the rain descended is simply all the challenges of life. Remember, I told you when rain falls, it can either be for good or for bad. When farmers pray for rain to fall, they pray for the rain to fall so that their crops can grow. Isn't it?
Yes.
But in this case, it's telling us that when the rain falls, when your enemies are waging war against you, when things are not going well for you in your life, when the wind comes, when witches and wizards are attacking you left, right, front, and center. But what happens? Because you've made the rock your foundation. Because you've made every aspect of your life. You've made Christ the foundation of every aspect of your life. Your bone marrow is founded on Christ. Your blood, the foundation is Christ. Your action, the foundation is Christ. Your words, your meditation, the foundation is Christ. And he's telling you, if you make the rock your foundation, when all these things happen, you'll be standing. You will stand.
Amen.
We will stand.
Amen.
But you have to make Christ your foundation. You have to make the rock your foundation. Deuteronomy 32, 3 to 4, what is it telling us?
Because I will publish the name of the Lord.
Yes.
Of the Lord. Ascribe ye greatness unto our God.
Yes.
He is the rock. His work is perfect.
His works are perfect.
For all his ways are judgment.
Yes, go ahead.
A God of truth.
Thank you. It says he is, God is the rock.
Yes.
All his ways are perfect. How many times do you and I embark on a journey? How many times do we put a strategy together and we're trying to make a decision and we're working hard towards achieving that goal, but we find out that we're just wasting our time? That's usually because we have not made that our foundation for that purpose is not Christ. We have not put that decision in front of Christ to say, oh my Lord, my Savior, I'm trying to make this decision. Guide me. That's usually what happens to weak Christians when we don't make Christ the rock. When we don't make Christ the foundation of everything that we do. The message is clear. It's something we hear all the time. Not everyone who calls. When I read it, I was frightened. Because I look at myself, I come to worship God, I strive as much as possible to do his will, and God forbid, he says, not everyone who calls upon me, but those who obey my words, those who do my will. And I thought to myself, am I really, really doing the will of God? You know, people can advise you, people can counsel you, but it becomes the time in your life where you sit down in the corner of your room and you reflect on what you're doing. You reflect on where you are. I do that every day to myself at night. Hey, God, what have I done today that is not right in your sight? People can advise you, their words can sound good to the ear, but if you don't sit down and talk to yourself, if you don't allow the Holy Spirit to minister to you, then God forbid, that will not be our portion.
Amen.
Now, what does it say about those Christians who refuse to do the word of God?
And everyone that
from verse 26. Go ahead.
And everyone that heareth the sayings of mine.
Everyone that hears the words of God.
And doeth them not.
And does not do them.
Shall be likened unto a foolish man.
Yes.
Which built his house upon the sand.
Okay.
And the rain descended.
Yes.
And the floods came.
Yes.
And the winds blew.
Yes.
And beat upon the house.
Yes.
And it fell.
Yes.
And great was the fall of it.
Key word, it fell. It didn't just fall, but great was the fall. It's different than if you have a plastic cup in your on your table and you accidentally hit it and it falls. What happens? It will bounce back. It will still stay together. But if you have a glass cup that falls from a certain height, what happens? It shatters. But Christ is telling us those who don't make him their foundation, he will liken them unto a foolish man that goes to the beach to build a skyscraper. Then challenges will come left, right, front, and center. The wind will come. Witches and wizards will come. Your boss at your place of work will make life difficult for you. Your co-workers that you go to lunch with every day, they will make life hell for you Because when they're in front of you, they are smiling, they are paying for your lunch. But when they go behind you, they are doing something else. He's likening that unto a foolish man that builds his house on sand. May God forgive us our sins.
Amen.
Now, quickly, what's the judgment of those who don't make Christ their rock, who do not make Christ their foundation? The same second lesson from verse 22.
Many will say to me that day.
He said, many will say to me on that day, yes?
Lord, Lord.
Lord, Lord.
Have we not prophesied in thy name?
Did we prophesy in your name?
And in thy name have we cast out devils?
Yes.
And in thy name done many wonderful works?
Yes.
And then will I profess unto them?
Then will I profess unto them. God is a patient God. It's not like you and I that I'll say, okay, I had a social gathering, maybe I invited you, you didn't come. Then I see you the next time, I say, you didn't. No. He will profess to them simple. They will hear his words clearly. Yes, go ahead.
And then will I profess unto them.
Yes.
I never knew you. You
see, I never knew you.
Depart from me.
Depart from me.
Ye that work iniquity.
Ye that work iniquity. May that not be our portion.
Amen.
Now, as we walk this Christian walk, as we strive to make it to the kingdom of heaven, as we work hard to obey the commandments of God, to do his will, he's telling us to be careful of something. From verse 15, Matthew 7, what does it say?
Beware of false prophets.
It says, beware of false prophets. Now, when it says beware of false prophets, it's not just talking about it's not even talking about the people who tie the blue line and call you out and give you a message from God. Beware of false prophets. He's talking about you and I. He's talking about we who advertise ourselves as commissioned Christians, who advertise ourselves as those who God has called to be used for his glory. Go ahead.
Beware of false prophets.
Yes.
Which come to you in sheep's clothing.
Yes.
But inwardly.
Yes.
They are ravening wolves.
Okay.
Ye shall know them by their fruits.
It says, ye shall know them by their fruits. Go ahead.
Do men gather grapes of thorns?
Thank you. Hold on 1 second there. He said we should beware of false prophets. Beware of false teachers. If you've ever been pulled over by a police officer for violating a traffic law, what happens? When they catch you, when they get you in the act, they drive behind you, right? Mm-hmm. And the next thing you know, they put on their lights. And you see from your rear view mirror, if you see red, blue, and white. They say, oh my God, the first thing you look at your speed limit, oh, do I have my license? Do I have this? Yeah. They pull you over. They walk up to you. They identify themselves. I'm, officer so-so-so of the New Jersey State Trooper or the Ewing Township Police, But they'll tell you who they are before they tell you your offense, and collect your documents or whatever. But if you're driving, and usually the police, the law enforcement officers, their cars are usually marked. State troopers, we all know they have the upside down triangle. You see New Jersey State Police, right?
Yes.
If it's a local police, you see Ewing, New Jersey Police. But if you're driving and someone comes behind you in like a, 1989 Honda Accord, and they look like they are dressed in uniform, but they have a torchlight, and they are doing like this, and they are shouting with a, what they call that?
Megaphone.
Pull over. You say, this one is a fake police. So you wouldn't pull over, right?
No.
Okay. So that's what God is telling us this morning. You have to let the Spirit of God direct you to be able to detect those false teachers. It's only by the Spirit of God. With the example I just gave now, it's pretty much common sense. If you've been pulled over, but if you've never been pulled over and you're a new driver, then, or if you're from a different country, then you may or may not know. But you have to allow the Spirit of God to dwell in you. You have to ask the Spirit. You have to ask God to grant you that spirit of discernment. Thank you, man. So that when you see these false teachers, you'll be able to recognize them. Like the Bible says, By their fruit you shall know them. And when you think about these false teachers, many of them, their motivation is a few things. One of a few things, either is money. They want to deceive you so you can be spending your money on them. Either is fame. They want to be famous, to be known as those who, like you said, Father God, when didn't we prophesy in your name? Didn't we cast out demons in your name? Fame. They want to be known as the healers. Or power. Like we all know. So when they go into a place, people will rise up. Hey, that's... But if you have that spirit of discernment, you'll be able to distinguish a false teacher from a true teacher. And all of us are teachers. All of us are prophets here.
Hallelujah.
1 John 4.
Yes.
Beloved, believe not every spirit, but try the spirits whether they are of God.
Yes.
Because many false prophets are gone out into the world.
Yes.
Thereby know ye the spirit of God.
Yes.
Every spirit that confesseth that the Jesus Christ is
Lord. He says, every spirit that confesses Jesus Christ is Lord. So when that prophet, when that teacher is coming to you, if whatever they're telling you is not in alignment with the word of God. Yes, sir.
And every spirit that confesseth not that Jesus Christ is come in the flesh.
Okay.
Is not of God.
Is not of God.
This is that spirit of the Antichrist.
Yes.
Wherefore you have heard.
Yes.
That it should come, and even now already is in the world.
Are the words of God making sense to us?
Yes.
Since we should test the spirits, some of them, in an attempt to deceive us, they'll tell us their history. They'll tell, oh, they'll tell us their history. Say, oh, when the church was descended, oh, I was there, I was with the pastor founder. Uh-huh. You know, there were other pastors there, you know. I went in to serve the pastor's soft drinks, and all of a sudden the window opened, wind was blowing, the light just shone on me. Then the pastor said, you are a man of God from, you know. They will tell you all sorts of stories. Meanwhile, they've forgotten that they are telling you the dates they are giving you. They say, oh, in 1950 something. But they've forgotten that a few minutes before they started telling you that story, they told you how they celebrated their birthday last week. And you find out, but you're not even up to 30, and you're telling me what happened. You know? So, but you have to let the Spirit of God dwell in you. You have to make the Spirit of God your foundation. So when you detect these false prophets, when they come to you and they're trying to deceive you, God will grant you that spirit of discernment, and you'll be able to choose left from right. Can someone quickly open the book of 2 Peter, chapter 2? It says, but there were also false prophets among you. Yes.
Even as there shall be false teachers among you.
Okay.
Who privily shall bring in damnable heresies.
Yes.
Even denying the law that brought them.
Yes.
And bring upon themselves swift destruction.
Okay.
And many shall follow their pernicious way.
Yes.
By reason of whom the way of truth shall be evil spoken of.
Yes.
And through covetousness shall they with feigned words make merchandise of you.
Yes.
Whose judgment now of a long time lingereth not.
Yes.
And their damnation slumbereth not.
Yes.
For if God spared not the angels.
It says, if God did not spare the angels when they sinned. Yes.
But cast them down to hell.
It says, but cast them down to hell.
And deliver them into chains of darkness.
Yes.
To be reserved unto judgment.
Okay.
And spared not the old world, but saved Noah, the eighth person, a preacher of righteousness, bringing in the flood upon the world of the ungodly.
Yes.
And turning the cities of Sodom and Gomorrah into ashes.
Okay.
Condemns them with an overthrow.
Yes.
Making them an ensample unto those that after should live ungodly.
Yes.
And deliver just Lot, vexed with the filthy conversation of the wicked.
Yes.
For that righteous man dwelling among them.
Yes.
In seeing and hearing.
Yes.
Vexed his righteous soul from day to day.
Okay.
With their unlawful deeds. The Lord knoweth how to deliver the godly out of temptation.
He says the Lord knows how to deliver the godly out of temptation. If you've not made God your foundation, if you've not made Christ your rock, then I'm sorry, you can't be delivered out of temptation. Yes.
The Lord knoweth how to deliver the godly out of temptation.
Okay.
And to reserve the unjust unto the day of judgment.
Yes.
To be punished.
Yes.
But chiefly them that walk after the flesh in lust of uncleanness.
Yes.
And despise government. Presumptuous are they. Self-willed, they are not afraid to speak evil of dignities.
Yes.
Whereas angels, which are greater in power and might, bring not railing accusation against them before the Lord.
Thank you very much for the sake of time. Now, if God did not spare the angels, how much more you and I who are flesh? The kingdom of God is the most important business for every Christian. Because the day and time that our lives will be taken, no one knows. Many people went to bed last night, they were not given the privilege to wake up this morning. It's not because we are better than them. It's not because we are more righteous. But it's because that's the time God wanted to call them. That's the time God has assigned that their lives will be taken. So as long as you and I still have breath, as long as you and I still serve the only living God, the God who sits enthroned and makes the earth his footstool, yes, then we must worship him if we want to make it into the kingdom of heaven.
Yes.
We must do his will. We must have no other God but him. We must love our neighbors as ourselves. We must help those who are in need. May God restore our blessings. The first lesson is Ezekiel 36, 1 to 15.
Also,
yes.
Thou son of man,
yes.
Prophesy unto the mountains of Israel,
yes.
And say,
yes.
Ye mountains of Israel,
yes.
Hear the word of the Lord.
He says, children of God, hear the word of the Lord, yes?
Thus said the Lord God,
okay.
Because the enemy hath said unto you, aha, even the ancient high places are ours in possession.
Okay.
Therefore, prophesy and say,
yes.
Thus said the Lord God,
okay.
Because they have made you desolate,
yes.
And swallowed you up on every side,
yes.
That ye might be a possession unto the residue of the heathen,
okay.
And you are taken up in the lips of talkers.
Sorry, because of time, just skip all that and go to verse 8.
But ye, O mountains of Israel.
But you, O Christians of Celestial, yes?
Ye shall shoot forth your branches.
Yes.
And yield your fruits to my people, amen. Of Israel. For they are at hand to come.
Yes.
For behold,
yes.
I am for you.
Yes.
And I will turn unto you.
Yes.
And ye shall be tilled and sown.
Thank you for the sake of time. Now this second lesson is telling us that as we continue to strive to enter the kingdom of heaven, the second lesson has told us to beware of false teachers, false prophets. Now the first lesson is telling us that all those things the enemy has stolen from us, that he will restore unto us.
Amen.
Provided we serve him, provided we worship him, provided we do his will. It's very challenging as a Christian because a lot of times you find yourself, you take steps forward, but certain situations will arise in your life that might make you take a step backward. But if you make Christ your rock, if you make the foundation of everything, if you make Christ the foundation of everything you do, be it in your place of work, be it in your education, be it in your relationships, be it in your business, he will always be there for you. Just like he said, when the winds come, when witches and wizards rise up against you, when they torment you in your sleep, because your focus is on God, he will always come for you.
Amen.
There's nothing we will go through in this earth that the Lord does not know. For some of us, as Christians, he even approves certain things to happen to us just to strengthen us. As a Christian, you must face challenges. You must. There's no two ways about it. You must. If you call yourself a Christian, if you say you have accepted Christ as your Lord and Savior, if you've made Christ your rock, if you've made God your foundation, you must go through challenges. Just like in the political world, we recently just concluded election. Imagine, let's say, like a little boy from this church during the November or prior to the November election, say, oh, he wants to run for presidency. What will happen? No one will pay him attention because they'll say, ah, he's not valuable. But the reason you and I will face those challenges, some of the reason is because the enemy knows our value. The enemy knows the value of the Spirit of God in you. The enemy knows what we can do when we have the Spirit of God and what we cannot do. If I'm standing at the train station holding a $100 bill, I'm sure a lot of people will be looking at me, the ones who want to snatch that money from my hand. and take off. Because that money has what? Value. Same thing with you and I. Because you are a Christian, the enemy knows the value. So they want to do things that will snatch that value from you. But if I'm standing at a train station or standing anywhere outside where there are a whole bunch of people, and I'm holding a white piece of paper, who will give me attention? Nobody. But because you have something in you, because that rock is in you, you must face challenges. And some of these challenges will come in the forms of false teachers, false prophets. They will come in the forms of challenges like the first lesson made us to understand. But as long as you're focused on Christ, when the rain, when the storm, when the wind comes, you will stand strong. But if you are not focused, may that not be our portion.
Amen.
In conclusion, 2 Peter 2 from verse 3, what does it say?
Second Peter 1 verse 3. According as his divine power,
yes,
has given unto us all things that pertain unto life,
yes,
and godliness,
yes,
through the knowledge of him that has called us.
Sorry, for the sake of time, just go to verse 5.
And beside this,
yes,
giving all diligence,
yes,
add to your faith virtue,
yes,
and to virtue,
yes,
knowledge.
Yes.
And to knowledge, temperance.
Yes.
And to temperance, patience.
Okay.
And to patience, godliness.
Yes.
And to godliness, brotherly kindness.
Yes.
And to brotherly kindness, charity.
Yes.
For if these things be in you.
Yes.
And abound.
Yes.
They make you that ye shall neither be barren.
Yes.
Nor unfruitful.
Yes.
To the knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ.
Okay.
But he that lacketh these things.
But he that lacketh these things, yes.
Is blind.
Is blind.
And cannot see afar.
And can't see far, yes.
And is forgotten.
Yes.
That he was purged from his old sins.
Yes.
Wherefore.
Therefore.
The rather.
Yes.
Brethren.
Yes.
Give diligence to make your calling and election sure.
He says give diligence to make your calling and election what? Sure.
For if ye do these things.
Yes.
Ye shall never fail.
You shall never fail. If you do these things, you shall never fail. If we do these things on the day of judgment, when we're before our Lord and our Savior Jesus Christ, God welcome us in.
Amen.
Make your election certain. Focus on Christ. We're in a world right now where the things that go on, you can't understand them. A lot of times when my wife and I discuss this, she will say, but what is wrong with people? Why are people doing this? Why? I said, because they don't have that grace. It's because you and I, brothers and sisters, have the grace as Christians. That's why we can understand that some of these things, or many of these things, are wrong. You hear of people killing each other here and there. You hear of all sorts of things. But if Christ is not your foundation, you won't understand. And if care is not taken, the more you listen to the news and hear all the atrocities that are going on, you'll be stirring up anger within yourself. But because we have faith in this God, because we trust in him, that as long as we do his will, as long as we obey his commandments, we'll make it to the kingdom of heaven.
Amen.
Brothers and sisters, let's be vigilant. Let's be spiritually vigilant at every point. Because all around us, there are false prophets, there are false teachers. Some people will come to you, they'll tell you, well, if God exists, then why is this happening? If God sits in heaven and makes the earth his footstool, who are we? You'll say, well, but you serve this God, you worship this God, why is this happening to you? Why is that happening to you? We must all go through challenges. And the outcome of our challenges will determine the next level God will take us to. Because in the same words, he said, to whom much is given, much is expected. May the Lord bless his holy word.
Amen.